Yeah, Father, I thank you for David. I thank you for his ministry. I thank you, Father, what you brought this morning. I just ask you, Lord, a fresh anointing upon him, Father. We pray for Linda as well as David, Father. Mm. Pray for their marriage, Father, their health, Father, vigor, strength, and camp around them. Plead the precious blood of Christ over them. And Father, we ask you, Lord, that we prepare our hearts right to receive what you have for us this morning. In the precious name of Jesus.
There you go. Right. Technology catches up. So, I thought this morning we would go for a bit of a treasure hunt. There are some real treasures in the Word of God. I wasn't particularly expecting one, I must admit, to be honest with you, when I started looking at Jeremiah, but there are some real treasures in there. So, let's just read through. This is how this all started for me. Starting Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 1. What a better place to start. Actually, I'll start the introduction in my Bible as well. But, the words of Jeremiah. Now, just listen to what's happening here as we go through. The words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests who were in Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. It also came in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, until the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, until the carrying away of Jerusalem captive in the fifth month. Just spot where this starts. Just before they get taken away into captivity. Just get that sort of scenario in your mind. The word of the Lord came to me saying, behold, I formed you, Jeremiah, in the womb. I knew you before you were born. I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Can you imagine Jeremiah thinking, what? Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak for I am a youth. Yeah, you appreciate that, don't you? You've got to be joking, Lord. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Notice he hasn't told you what to say yet. He's just saying, Jeremiah, this is who you are. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set you over the nations and over the kingdoms, to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. He's really building Jeremiah up there, isn't he? Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? And I said, I see a branch of an almond tree. And I thought, what? What is going on here? I see a branch of an almond tree. Then the Lord said to me, you have seen well, for I am ready, or I am watching over my word to perform it. And the word of the Lord, and I thought, hang on, this is really strange. I don't understand that. But you know, sometimes, or quite often for me actually, if I don't understand it, I look at it and think, do I understand that? No, I don't. I'll just pass over that and carry on. And the word of the Lord came to me the second time saying, what do you see? And I said, I see a boiling pot and it's facing away from the north. Then the Lord said to me, and then there's this long passage where the Lord describes what he's going to do to Israel because they turned away from him. Now, I won't read it all to you because it will take too long. But I carried on then into chapter 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think I got to about chapter 7. But as I read through, you know, I kept in my mind was still back at the, I see an almond tree, almond bush. And it didn't leave my mind as I was reading through. And I got to chapter 7, I thought, that's it, I've had enough of this. I'm not ploughing through this anymore. I'm going to go back and look at the almond bush, because I just can't get it out of my mind, you. So, that's what Jeremiah saw. I thought, what a strange vision. An almond branch. Now God had just told him he's going to go and talk to the nations and he suddenly sticks this almond branch in front of his face. I don't understand that. Do you know? do you know what this is all about? Well, I didn't. I'm sure there are some really good theologians here who do. But I didn't. And I said, Lord, pass. But I thought I'd better look at it because, you know what, my spirit is excited about that and my brain cannot understand why. Have you ever been like that? When God prompts your spirit is like this, yeah, yeah, and your brain's thinking, what's going on? The two aren't in sync at all. And I was like that. But I knew, and I spotted before when God did that to my spirit, I knew he was going to try and show me something. My brain was just not caught up yet. So I thought, well, I know what I have to do. I have to look hard at it. So I said, come on then, Lord. Do your job. Explain it to me because I'm a bit thick. Now, if you were Jeremiah, you'll probably understand Hebrew. Well, you would, because that's what he spoke. And Jeremiah would have immediately understood what God was saying. And I didn't. So I looked and I could see that God was, he was using some pictorial and wordplay thing to say something to Jeremiah, which at that point to Jeremiah was absolutely obvious and to me was. So I said, okay, Lord, I love these dad-son conversations you can have with God. You can say, hang on, Dad, please. I said, okay, Lord. I can see you doing something with words and pictures here, but could you explain it to me by doing it in English, please? Not Hebrew. I'll have to go and see Noel if I wanted to understand that. And you know, the instant I did that, bless his heart, he dropped a picture into my head. The instant. This is the picture. Now, come on, if you saw that picture, what do you think God would be saying to you? And if you don't know, that's fine.
Is it a rosary?
There's the question. What is in the palm of his hand there is time. What do you think God might be saying? Come on. Time is in my hand. I said to God, I think you'd be saying time is in my hand. But you're using the word time and it sounds the same, but it's not spelt the same. And God said, that's right. And it was the same here for Jeremiah. I thought, you know, if God had said that, he wasn't actually saying that, God was just using that as an example. Whenever I saw that picture, I would remember precisely what God was saying, wouldn't you? Once you've had it explained to you and catch it and get it, I'd think every time I saw that, time is in my hand. So God very cleverly was using a picture to encapsulate what he was saying to Jeremiah. And he was using wordplay. You see the wordplay between time and time there? We'll look at that. Now, so God said it's the same with Jeremiah. So let's look now at Jeremiah. He first shows Jeremiah the vision of this almond tree. Now, Jeremiah actually knows a lot about almond trees. He comes from a town, right back in verse 1 it tells us, he comes from a town called Anathoth. That's where Anathoth is. It's about 3 miles north of Jerusalem. Here. So this is about 3 miles. And Bethlehem's about sort of 4 miles or so south. So that's the sort of area. And you'll find Anathoth mentioned in Joshua. When the people came into the promised land, the Levites weren't given a land, but they were given cities. Yeah, they were given 48 cities in that whole promised land. One of them was Anathoth. So it was a city for the Levites. Yeah. And by the way, that reminds us that Jeremiah was a Levite. Right? Now, one of the things about Anathoth, if you study it, which I had to go and do, was it's well known as being an almond growing area. I didn't know that. So Jeremiah would have known a lot about almond trees, wouldn't he? So when God says, well done, you seem well, when Jeremiah says, I see an almond tree, you think, well, obviously, Jeremiah would have known everything about almond trees, wouldn't he? He definitely could have spotted one from 1,000 miles away. Yeah. So him saying, I see an almond tree, and God saying, you've seen well, you think, hang on. No. God's not saying, well done, you've seen an almond tree. He's saying, well done, Jeremiah, you've seen something else. You've seen something else. And you'd only realise that when you realise that Jeremiah already knew about almond trees. Yeah? No, Jeremiah had seen something else. So let's have a look at that. There's an almond tree at the top. Just notice before we go on. You'll find the almond tree has almond fruit and blossom and in fact buds all at the same time. You'll notice that as we go through. But have a look here for the word almond. What's that mean? Swap me over. Good idea. Now, the word in Hebrew for almond is shokad. Shokad, it's pronounced shokad. When God says, well done, for I'm watching over my word to perform it, the word watching is shokad. And you can see that the words, when it's like time and time, almost identical. If you set them in a sentence, you'd almost be replacing one for the other. And God is using...
And bear in mind that Hebrew...
I knew he'd say it. I knew at this point I could take a break.
Hebrew didn't have vowels like we have vowels, no. So you would have only seen the consonants in the two words, so Hebrew would have been written S-H-Q-D, which is the same in both words.
Yeah, exactly. So you see the similarity in the actual written word, but also the similarity in the sound. Yeah, just like time. Time. At this point, I think I should elevate or something. Okay. So, just capture this thought. God has done two things. Is it here? Not really. All right, the moment, Sam. Okay, so use both. I might move around, that's the trouble. Actually, if I'm going to move around, I'd grab this.
Very Tom Jones.
I don't look like Tom Jones at all, you must be joking.
It's not unusual.
Yeah. To be loved by. Oh, yeah.
No.
So, you'll be in detention at the moment. Again. So, God is doing two things here. He's giving him a word play. Yeah? I don't know how you think you pronounce those two, no?
No.
They say shokade and shokad.
Yeah, that's right.
In Strong's Dictionary.
I've got all my Hebrew
out. Uh-huh. But he's also giving him a picture which encapsulates that. And I believe from that second on, whenever Jeremiah thought of the almond branch or saw one, he'd think, God is watching over his word to perform it, you know, because that's what the picture says. Yeah. And you do see that other places in the Bible, these sorts of wordplay. God is very clever. You know, he says a picture says 1,000 words, doesn't it? Well, once you've got that picture, it will speak to you time and time again. So let's just look at what happened to Jeremiah then. First, Jeremiah was called by God into service. Let's move on. Oh, I forgot to say this. I underlined the us. Because this is God's word to us today. It's not just a history lesson. But God says he's watching over his promises to perform them. And I believe he's saying that to us as well today. Let's just go back again. He calls Jeremiah into his service, and if you remember in those first few verses, he reassures him that he's known him before he was born, that he's with him, that he's going to protect him, and he's giving words into his mouth to speak. Remember that building up before this picture? But now, he's going this step further. And he's reassuring Jeremiah that when I give you the things to say, I, your Lord God, am watching over them to perform them. God is taking responsibility for the words that he's given Jeremiah and said, you say them, Jeremiah, I am taking responsibility to ensure that they happen. Wow, that's excellent, because Jeremiah just had to go and say them, didn't he? He just had to go and do what God asked him to do. And God says, I am ensuring those things come to pass. Not you, Jeremiah. I am. I think that's really reassuring, you know, that God himself says he's going to watch over those words to fulfill them. And we do need to just pause for a moment and remind ourselves there isn't one single prophecy or promise of God that he has ever forgotten. He has never forgotten. He's never put away in some dusty corner, neglected corner. But each and every promise of God, God remembers and actively watches over to bring them to fulfillment. That is a wonderful truth. So, I can't quite remember where we are here. Nine, okay. Remember Jeremiah is a Levite from Anathoth. He would have known his Jewish history. Yeah? And I believe as he spotted what God was saying, into his mind came something. First of all, several things actually. He first of all would have remembered that rod of Aaron. Do you remember the rod of Aaron that said budded? What sort of rod was it? So I didn't hear that? No? It was an almond branch. Get it? But this is 625 years earlier. Be careful, it's a long time. And you remember there, it talks about the rebellion of Korah, the group of Levites headed by Korah complained to Moses and Aaron. And Aaron says, okay. Or rather, both, he says, okay, because God told him what to do. Go and get a rod from every tribe. All 12 tribes. But the one from the Levites, put Aaron's name on it. Write the name of the leader on the rod. On the Levite one, write the name of Aaron. I don't think Korah would be very happy with that, because he was expecting to be leader. Write Aaron's name on. And so Moses did that, and they brought them into the tabernacle, past the holy place with the lamp and the bread of the presence and the incense table, and then through into here, so only Moses could bring them past that point, to where the Ark of the Covenant was. And they laid them down. It doesn't say whether they laid them down on top or on the floor. I like to think they put them on the floor, but I don't know. They laid them in there. What happened to them? Well, overnight, 11 of them, nothing happened at all. When they came the next day, the rod, which was the Levite rod, which was the one with Aaron's name on, had done three things overnight. It had budded, it had blossomed, and had brought forth completely eatable, edible almond nuts in one night. And God was saying two things. First of all, just think of the story of Jeremiah. He was calling Aaron and selecting Aaron to be the high priest to go into that holy place. So God was recognizing that by causing that rod to blossom and fruit. God had just called Jeremiah, hadn't he? And what does he show him? An almond branch? Yeah. But God was also saying something else 625 years earlier, and I have a feeling that the Jews didn't know it. God was also saying, I'm watching over my word to perform it. What was inside the ark? You do know, Ada. I can see it's on your lips. Ten commandments. The commandments of God written and put in the ark. What was God watching over? Watching over his word to perform it. I don't think they recognised that. Jeremiah recognised it 600 years later. I have a feeling they hadn't recognised that before. They thought God was just calling Aaron into service. But actually he was doing more than that. He was also promising to watch over those commandments. And there it was. One rod. On it were buds and blossom and nuts. And if you look in number 17, you'll find that story. But you know, suddenly I think Jeremiah remembered something else. If you look in Exodus 25, verses 31 to 40, and Exodus 37, you'll find there the passage which describes God giving the plan for the lampstand. Might be worth just looking at that. So in Exodus, you need more than two hands. Verse 31, it says, you shall say, make a lampstand of pure gold. The lampstand shall be of hammered work, its shaft, its branches, its bowls, its ornamental buds and flowers shall be of one piece, blah, blah, blah. And then verse 33 says, three bowls shall be made like almond blossoms on one branch, and an ornamental bud and a flower, the three bowls made like almond blossoms. And it goes on through there. And what Jeremiah, I think, will have remembered was that the whole design for the lampstand was based on an almond branch. Had you ever spotted that before? Interesting, isn't it? But you sometimes have to work backwards from the revelation of God to see what he was setting in place before.
Can I just say something? The almond tree is the first tree to blossom.
I'm going to say that. Yes, I'll say that. Thank you. Yeah. No, no, you can't say.
I've got my rib now. I'm going to say that.
David, natural menorah is being the lampstand is in Jewish tradition, I think, as it comes through, is to be a witness. It represents being a witness, and you find that in the Laodicea, in the seven churches, the church is to be a lampstand as well, which is to be a witness.
Yes. No. So Gary's just saying that the lampstand is supposed to represent being a witness. Actually, what I believe is the part that's supposed to be a witness is the actual light at the top. So that's why, see all the lights on the top, that's our light into the world, as you say. But if you just look underneath that, sometimes you've got to look at what things are underneath, don't you? You say, what's God saying underneath that witness? He's actually yet again saying, I'm watching over my word to perform it. Through you, in that case, in terms of being a witness, yeah? There's a consistency here. Which I don't think I'd ever spotted. Well, I hadn't ever spotted. And I have a feeling the Jews hadn't spotted, you know. For 625 years they'd had this stuff until God reveals this to Jeremiah. And suddenly your eyes open, you say, wow, God, you're not only calling Aaron and Jeremiah into service, but you're also saying whatever you ask them to do, you are going to watch over to make sure those things happen. Mm. That is brilliant. Sometimes you've got to look for these hidden truths in God, you know. And remember that. So I said to the Lord, wow. Words to that effect. Wow. So why are you telling me this? And sometimes, you know, we know the promises of God. And perhaps when we're younger in the faith, we've first seen them and they're really strong in us, aren't they? Wow, those things are brilliant. Do you know, over time, the strength of those things fades. We get so familiar with them, not that they become contemptible, not that phrase, but the strength of them diminishes and the fire in them burns down to a warm ember. I think it's very interesting that this morning, when we've been singing, God has reminded us time and time again through those songs about his love, his faithfulness, salvation. He's through those songs, he's reminding us of what we already know, isn't he? And he's saying, come on, remember them again. If you're like me, somehow my heart just doesn't respond as strong as it used to, just because I don't know it all, me, you know? Interesting, if you look in 2 Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 12, it says, for this reason I will not be negligent to remind you always of these things, what we're like. He knew we'd just sort of begin to get more dull about those things than we were originally. He says, yes, I think it's right. As long as I am in this tent, to stir you up by reminding you. So I said, okay, I guess that's what you're doing to me then, Lord. You're reminding me. He said, yes. So I asked God, so what promises are you reminding me of? Because there's a lot of them in the Word, aren't there? You know, and I don't know if anyone, you know, somebody will have counted them all, but I don't know how many there are. The reason being that today God wants to reignite them. How do you use that? Stir up a fire, I suppose. You rake it around, didn't you? And then suddenly it will burst into flame again. It's like God wants to do that. So don't expect to hear anything that you haven't heard before. Don't expect that. But expect God to say to you, do you remember that verse? Do you remember that promise? Is it really living in you? And if I felt God say to me, there's a difference between knowing the Word of God and living the Word of God. Mm-hmm. Satan knows the Word of God better than you or me, perhaps. He is not living it. So God wants us to live that. And therefore those words have got to be life in us, haven't they? Life and breath. They've got to be reignited and burning us as strongly as they ever did. And if you, I'll admit it, even if some of you may not, which is a lot of those promises, I've just sort of, they're on the back burner. I think, yeah, I know that. But I'm not really enjoying them as much as I used to. So I said to the Lord, what do you want us to do? He said this. He said, look over them again and remind yourselves. Let them warm your hearts again and be encouraged. The reason was he wants us to be encouraged by reminding us what we already know. Through what I've surely promised you, so that you may stand firmly on them in the coming days. We've spoken much about 3 months of preparation here. God will want to say lots of things to us. One of the things he wants to do is to make sure not only is there a firm foundation, what is the firm foundation? Jesus. Now he wants to put a few bricks in place. All right? So, here's the first one. I said, come on, there were lots of these, Lord. Keep it short, sweet, and focus, please, sort of thing. I didn't actually say that. I said, which do you want us to remember? I sort of thought it, but I didn't say it. He said, well, he told me specifically, this is the first one, Numbers 23. God is not a man that he should lie. nor the Son of Man that he should repent? Has he said, and will he not do? Question mark. Or has he spoken, and will he not make it good? How many times have we held on to a promise and thought it's not going to happen? Therefore, perhaps I was wrong in hearing. And if you're not able to verbalise it, sometimes in your spirit you're thinking, did God really stick to that promise? I'm sorry, God is not a liar. God is not a liar. If you look in Corinthians, it says that. Just so we don't get into, oh, but that was Old Testament, not you. Yeah? All of the promises of God are yes in him, which is Jesus. All of the promises of God. So God starts by...
also impossible for God to lie.
And as Gary says, yeah, there are lots of other scriptures, but these are the two that God said, all right? It's impossible for God to lie. Just remember that. It is a truth. It's written in the Word of God. If you don't believe that is true, then you are wrong. The Word of God is not wrong. And I have to say that to myself. Because if you want to lay a foundation at all, actually, that's where you start. If you don't believe that, you're not going to believe Jesus. You have to believe that this is true. So let's build on this foundation. Yeah? And get to the very obvious one, which is like Jeremiah. He said, I will, never leave you nor forsake you. It's in Hebrews, it's also in the Old Testament as well. Have you ever felt that's true? That God perhaps has left you? It is a feeling I have felt. That I believe you, I know who you are, but I don't feel you're near me. Yeah? But that is a lie inside me. Because God said, no, I'm never going to leave you or forsake you. Right? So let these truths just get re-established again inside us, yeah? And the one which we thought we'd go and jump to, I thought you'd bring this one up. How many times have I said in my Christian life, oh, am I really a Christian? Did I really commit myself to Jesus? Did I really do it wholeheartedly? I don't seem to be walking correctly. And then I say, you know, I did. I really believed in Jesus and I really confessed that he was the Lord of my life, that he died for me. And therefore I have to come and hang on to this scripture that says, therefore, if you confess with your mouth that the Lord Jesus as your Saviour and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. No ifs, no buts. You will be saved. So, like me, if you've ever wondered, I thought perhaps I'd do it again, just in case. God says, you will be saved. Do you know what God's doing? He's just building an assurance in us again. When Satan tries to knock and shake things, he says, I want you to have a firm grounding here. It says there's nothing that Satan can do that can stop you from being saved. I find that quite encouraging. So that set of five there. You know, he's promised he's never going to lie to us. Our future is secure in him and so on. We are saved. Yeah. Let's go on. Number six, I think. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Do you know there's only one condition in there? Did you notice? And it is to ask. I remember taking that scripture 40 years ago, and on my own in my bedroom, kneeling down and saying, that is what your word says. I don't know what it means to walk in the Spirit in those days. I don't seem to have people around to tell me,
but this is what your word says. And it says, I just have to ask. And so I just knelt and said, please, can I have the Holy Spirit, please? It took some years after that before I understood how to respond to the Holy Spirit being in me, but I knew that God had promised. So all that's required, if you want the Holy Spirit in you, is you say, yes, please, I'll have some of that, Lord. Please give it to me. I'm sure we've all done it. But if ever you speak to somebody who's not sure, just say they have to ask, and that is all. Yeah? Ha! If this isn't a mainstay of your life, it certainly is for me. He who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Will, not might, not you'll ever think about it, not oh, it all depends. God says, will. Ah, oh, he's so black and white, isn't he? Thank goodness. He has begun a good work in me and you, and he will complete it. Oh, thank goodness. Thank you, Lord. Who's going to complete it?
Jesus.
Not him. He's so actively involved in us. He says, I commit myself. Because you've committed yourself to me, I commit to you to complete in you everything I have planned for you. Not only what I promised in the word, perhaps some things he's personally planned for you as well. He will fulfill those things. Don't get bored by these things, because I know you know every single one of them. We're just going back over them. My God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Have you ever had that tussle? I need this, Lord. I need this. I need this. And I haven't got it. And you're not supplying it. But his promise says he will. He will supply all you need, not all you want. See, you know it, don't you? Well, I know it too. But let's remind ourselves, he says, I will, I shall. No ifs and no buts, I shall. Thank you, Lord. Eh? Ha! I don't know what to do here, Lord. I don't know which way to go. I don't know what's a good thing or bad thing. I need to be wise about this, Lord. How are you going to be wise? I guess you do that, wouldn't you? Right? If any of you lacks wisdom, some of us don't. Is that perhaps? I do. So I would rewrite that and say, all of the time when I lack wisdom, let him ask of God who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Not might or, oh, you've had a lot last week, you're not having any more this week. No, liberally. He will give the wisdom that's needed. You know, I in the past have asked God for wisdom and then not trusted the wisdom he's given me. Horrible catch 22. Oh, did God give me that? Was that really from God? But you know, we've got to begin to trust God working inside us. When he says, I'll make you wise, he will when you ask. Ha. When you put them all together, you think, wow, there's the first layer of bricks, isn't it? You know, foundation in God, not lying, Jesus, and then these things that he promises us. Holy Spirit, wisdom, and so on. Supplying all you need. Never giving up on you. Never gives up, never lets go. Isn't that what we sing? We sang it last week, I know. Never gives up, never lets go. What are those songs based on? These sure promises of God. Yeah? Ha! He's walking with us, filling us with his Holy Spirit, supplying everything we'll need, completing his working us. Oh, hallelujah is what I say again. Oh, I've forgotten about those things. Hallelujah. It gives me an assurance, and my heart feels, yes, everything's going right. You know? And then he says this. Do you know, he says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And when I've prepared it, I'm going to come again. And we all think, oh, yeah, I know that. Hang on. He is preparing a place. He's got your name on the front door. Not just he's building places, but he's building a place with your name on. He's building a place with my name on. So keep out of my place. You know, reserved in heaven for you and for you and for you. And you think, oh yeah, it's a long time perhaps to that, or in my case, perhaps not too long. But it's still true. You need to know where you're going from a God who never lies. And he says, you know, part of that house is the fact that you have an inheritance in me. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again, born again, to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, so it hasn't been hacked in any way, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. That is a great promise. Can you see what God's done? If you put all of those 11 together, what has he just done? He said, I'm building you a picture here. I never lie. Jesus has saved you as long as you confess me. I'm supplying everything you need, wisdom, Holy Spirit, and so on, whilst you're alive. And here I am, promising you what comes next. A, I will come back to you, but where am I taking you? What are you going to find there? And what is this inheritance you've got? That is a wonderful picture. I wish I was an artist and could somehow paint something that captured all of those at once. The panoply of God's promises to us from the past and into the future. I think they're wonderful, wonderful. And God's saying to us, you need to perhaps get that list of scriptures and go over them again for yourself. Just go through them. You know, God, minister those truths to us. Because sometimes when you put more on the table at once, you can't sort of remember them all. But he's asking us to bathe in the truth of them. Remember, God's saying this in a time of preparation. So he says, after this time of preparation, these need to be firm and living in you for whatever comes ahead. So bathing them and refresh that joy in you. It's the joy of those things which can die down. Be assured in them again. And rest in his faithfulness to you. Yeah? Now, those are all God's promises to every single Christian, aren't they? Isn't it? But on top of that, God also gives personal promises. Do you remember, for example, Abraham was promised that he'd be the father of many nations and so on? Well, God didn't promise that to other people. He just promised it to Abraham, you know, specific to him. Who would lead the people out of Egypt? It was Moses, that God says, you're the one. So sometimes God makes things very personal and specific. And they can come in various ways. They can come to us through dreams and visions and prophetic words from people, or some revelation of God, perhaps more infrequently, just God speaking out loud to you. And I've only ever had that once in my life. Yep. And whatever those promises are, whatever your brain is saying, if your spirit is saying, yes, God did actually say that to me, and despite everything else that's going on or has gone on, those promises were from God. If you know that, then I'd say God is still watching over those promises to you personally. And he's not forgotten them in any way. So So there's an almond tree in full blossom, and it's known as the watching tree, and indeed it's known as the hastening tree, and we'll come back to what Ada was just saying earlier. Yeah. And Ada obviously knows, let me just remind you, the almond tree is actually the very first tree to bud in Israel, the very first one, and it buds in late winter in the back end of January. That's when it starts. It's the very first tree to bud, and amazingly, in a very short period, between the last week of January and around the middle of March, perhaps slightly towards the latter end of March, in that just that short period, the almond tree will bud and will blossom and will bring nuts in that really short period of time. Amazing. That's why they think of it as hastening spring and summer. Yeah, but also they know Jeremiah. God says, well done, you've seen, for I'm hastening my word and watching over it to perform it. And what time of the year are we in right now? Not about the same, exactly the same. We are out now in the, what's the date? 5th of February. And I said to Paul the other week, I said, I need to bring this in February. Why? Because God laid it on my heart that this is his word to us right now. And bless his heart. It doesn't surprise me he says you better do it in February then, don't you? At this instant in time, the almond trees in Israel are in full blossom. There are buds, blossom, and already nuts. That's what's happening in Israel right now, this instant, today. And that's why that God's word to you and me today is the same. At this precise instant, my promises to you, personal ones or to everybody, have never changed. I want you to remember them and begin to live in them strongly. Back to that picture I showed you earlier. Can you imagine that now in Israel? It's not 1,000 years ago. This is now today. That picture. And it can be the picture for you and me. God both calling us into his service again and afresh, and also saying, I'll give you the words to say, I'll direct you what you've got to do, go do it, but I will look over everything I ask you to do and ensure that those things are fulfilled. That's God working with you and me. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? And that's why it says in John 15, you remember I said I wanted to go and read John?
Yes.
Well, I'm going to read it all, but I thought it was so funny at the end when God said, and don't forget that scripture. I thought it was the very last one. Oh, thank you, Lord. Yes, I can get back to John. This is Jesus himself promising that. Jesus himself saying, you did not choose me, but I choose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit. That's God's promise, and therefore he's watching over you and me to ensure that that's fulfilled. So my only suggestion is you take the almond branch that you can see in your mind and you write your name on it. Just like God said, write, whoever it was? Aaron, thank you. Write Aaron's name on it. Write your name on it and make that promise of God yours as well. Yeah? That God appoints you and says, go and bear fruit, I'm with you, supplying all you need, and I'll ensure that my promises never fail in you. And I don't think I need to say any more. Just take that picture in your mind, wherever you go now. Right now, on the 5th of February, yeah? Right when God says, I'm preparing you now for what's coming. and take it seriously and say, I'm not just going to believe the promise of God, I'm going to believe them for me, in my life. Yeah? And let them burn up and be strong in you. Don't look at others and say, oh yes, I think they'll burn up strongly in that person. God wants them to burn up in you and me. Yeah? Amen? Amen. Amen. That's it.
Exactly, it was over Christmas, and I think on the 1st of January, because I think I spoke here on Jesus walking over the water at the end of that
first week. It was during that first week that God gave me that. You know, precisely.
I'm not going to add to it either. Shall we just pray? Give today to the Lord. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the praise and worship. Thank you, Father, that we entered into your presence, Father, with thanksgiving in our hearts. Thank you, Father, for the communion, how we came and remembered what you've done, Father, for us. Thank you for the word this morning, Lord, that your promises are real and alive and up to date, Lord. And you're watching us, Father, individually and collectively. And so, Father, we thank you, Father, that you never change. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. You are the author and the finisher of our faith. And we owe you everything, Lord. And so, Father, thank you for being with us. Thank you for the love and the fellowship in this place, Father. And Father, let us not leave what we've received today at the door, but let us take it with us, Lord. It's ours. You've spoken to us, Lord. It's the living word. And so, Father, we thank you for your blessings, and we bless you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to have lunch now. And if you'd like to move the chairs and bring out the tables and help Angela bring the food over, that would be great. And lay up. And if afterwards you'd like to hand.